Thank you so much for joining us for the webinar today. This webinar is sponsored by the Department of Disability and Human Development through the TAP, Institute on Disability and Human Development, and Leadership Education and Neurodevelopmental Disabilities LEND program. We're excited to have Jae Jin Pak present today, and now I'll turn it over to Jae Jin.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Katie, for the introduction and the overview. As Katie said, my name is Jae Jin Pak, and thank you for joining today's webinar talking about addressing the intersection of disability and sexuality. A little bit about me and my background is I have over 25 years of experience working in mental health and trauma. I've done a lot of work around the issues of gender-based violence prevention, and as part of that, have gotten to understand the importance of recognizing and really valuing positive relationships and healthy relationships. I'm also identified as a person with a disability, a couple of disabilities actually, so some of the experiences and anecdotes that I'm going to share will come from my background, as well as experiences and ideas from colleagues, friends and acquaintances, and other colleagues from in the disability community doing this work. So one of the first things that I want to get from all of you is for you to, in the chat box, if you can share some ideas to this question of what comes to mind when you hear the words sex and disability. What ideas, thoughts, images comes to mind? And if you all can just throw them in the chat box, we'll go over those a little bit.
And this is Katie. To go ahead and respond to Jae Jin's question, feel free to go to the lower right-hand corner and open the Collaborate panel, and you'll see a speech bubble where you're able to type in your response to the question. What comes to mind when you hear the word sex and disability? So go ahead and so someone wrote social stigma barriers.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Consent.
Mm-hmm.
Words that come to mind are taboo, stigma, and consent. People with disabilities are often noted as not being sexual. Social taboo.
Mm-hmm.
Access issues, very black and white thinking regarding any issues.
Great. Well, thank you for those. Yes, it's interesting variety of ideas and everything from access issues, access to information, ideas and around consent and stigma and attitudes of people with disabilities not having sex or not being able to have sex. And we'll address a lot of these throughout the conversation. I mean, one of the things that I like to ask people when I've had this conversation or this type of presentation, something I like to ask is the very blunt question, why discuss sex and disability? And over the years, I've gotten people have shared comments of and ideas of, well, it's important. People with disabilities lack access to information. And in the in my work of doing gender-based violence work, people have acknowledged the reality that there's people with disabilities have increased risk for victimization, for sexual harassment and abuse and gender-based violence. But the really very basic direct answer to this question, and the reality that's really important for all of us to understand and accept, is the reality and the fact that people with disabilities are having sex. People with disabilities, as being people and human beings, are, as part of being people and who we are sexual beings. Sexuality, sexual identity, sexual expression, and everything that's underneath that umbrella, that broad umbrella of sexuality, is important to acknowledge, recognize, respect, value, and find ways of helping individuals with disabilities to accept and acknowledge and accept their sexual identities. Just like growing up as a child and adolescent and young man and an adult myself, living with low vision and seizure disorders, in getting lesson plans and information and people helping me understand and accept my disabilities, my low vision identity, my epileptic identity, and helping me to find, you know, positive value in that and adapt and incorporate and consider how my disabilities impact my ability to make friends, go to school, go to work. It was also equally important for me to encounter people and mentors and teachers and providers who also helped me understand or acknowledge my ideas of relationships and dating when those questions and ideas came up in appropriate settings. So I said a lot, and I guess I'm part of that is to acknowledge that when we talk about sexuality and sexual expression and sexual identity and gender identity, these are very personal, individualized, personal things. And there's no standard template. Everybody's different. And as we go through, a lot of things influence a person's journey in their sexual identity and gender identity and their exploration. And I think it's important, but it starts with this initial conscious, intentional acceptance. People with disabilities are having sex. And that goes to these other realities as well, that, you know, people with disabilities, one of the things when I touch upon stereotypes in a little bit, one of the realities that those of us in the disability community have experienced is being pigeonholed or just being seen or considered about our disability. And that parallels with my experience as a person of color of being Asian and Korean. I can think back to experiences where I was just seen, and everything on every assumption or interaction, in some cases, was based on the assumption of me being Asian. Similarly, I've had many numerous encounters with people who, once they realized I had a disability, all their interactions or assumptions was guided or directed by their assumptions or stereotypes around my disability. My personhood fell behind or fell through the cracks. And so, just as important as recognizing the fact that people with disabilities are having sex, that goes into the importance of understanding these realities, that we are people with disabilities, that our disability is just a part of who we are, the framework of our personhood. We have the full range and capacity of full range of emotional expression. We have the full capacity of the exploring gender expression. And within the very huge, diverse disability community is just as diverse of gender expression and sexual orientation and sexual identity. And the importance of, the range of intellectual expression as well. I spend a fair amount of time on this point because I think it's in my conversations and my experience, the simple fact of being seen as a person, of being seen of my personhood, humanity, dignity, integrity, respect, everything from persons' abilities, their occupation, their professional, their interests, artistic abilities. Sexual identity has something, as mentioned, because of some of the stigma and the taboo that's circulating in our society and in many of our cultures, the attitude of people with disabilities being sexual isn't something that is routinely accepted. And because society has a sense of discomfort around it, it's much easier to ignore or not get attention. But it is important, again, to recognize that we as people with disabilities, again, with the full access of all our emotional and gender and sexual expression, that is, again, part of who we are. So, moving, as I mentioned, in terms of some of the stereotypes and gets discussed, is and many of us, whether we identify as someone with a disability or have worked in the field of disability services, have encountered these kinds of attitudes, that people with disabilities are asexual, or conversely, people with disabilities are hypersexual, that people with disabilities don't understand what sex is, or aren't able to consent or understand what consent is. It's inappropriate for people with disabilities to have families, or how can they take care of children? Along with that, in terms of so there's some attitudes and some beliefs in our attitudes or beliefs in our society that people with disabilities are protected and are taken care of, so they're at lower risk of sexual victimization, which is not accurate, which is incorrect. Like any marginalized community, the reality is that people with disabilities are at increased risk of victimization. Some of these stereotypes that kind of reinforce each other. If people believe that people with disabilities don't understand sex or should not have sex, then it makes sense not to educate someone with about disabilities around their sexual identity or sex or sexuality or body parts. They don't need to know. Unfortunately, that lack of knowledge can increase risk of victimization, which we'll address in a little bit. But again, all these myths are out there, and they've been around there for a long time. And again, it's important for all of us to just kind of understand and acknowledge we've consumed this information for however long these have been out there. They're part of our background noise. And because they've been around our background noise, they may shape how we view or interact or perceive people with disabilities, just like stereotypes and misconceptions of other communities or other patients or other types of people, whether it's people of color, different faith traditions, LGBTQ community, whatever the different population or community might be, there are stereotypes. And those stereotypes have been around for ages. And they've been, all, again, been part of our background knowledge, background noise, and in some ways may shape how we perceive different communities. That's not to say that we're bad people or that individuals or people whose opinions or attitudes have been shaped by stereotypes inadvertently are have bad intent, or I'm not trying to shame anybody with this. It's just sharing the reality that this information is out there and that we have a choice. Understanding these messages are out there, we can make an effort and a choice to put a speed bump in our thought process so that we can choose not, or actually put it this way, we can choose to put the stereotypes aside so that when we're interacting with someone with a disability or a group of people with disabilities, we can make an active choice to put stereotype bias, like, I know I've consumed some information, misinformation. I'm going to try my best to put that aside and just focus on the information that the person or the community in front of me is giving me so that I can best share information or, you know, provide the best resource that I can in this situation without outside interference. And that's, again, true around sexuality. All the misinformation that we've consumed around just people with disabilities, you know, making an effort to say, I've heard all this, I'm going to put it aside and do my best to focus on the here and now. So, you know, some additional challenges that are related to culture and society that influences policy can be, you know, cultural attitudes. Different cultural communities have values, traditions, belief systems that shape how sexuality is seen and valued and interacted with. Similarly, family, along with that is family values and family history. All of that creates influences how someone sees, believes in, values sexuality and gender and everything else. So to acknowledge that and respect that. And the ongoing debate in many societies, but here within the U.S. Education system, the ongoing debate around comprehensive sex ed. What type of sexuality education and information is appropriate in education settings? How explicit, how direct, at what age level or grade level can we introduce language, body parts, what their function is, sexual activity? And it's an important debate and conversation to have, but something that a community that has not been as well represented in this debate is the disability community. It is important, you know, to acknowledge that those of the disability community, many of us going through education, we've had a lot of legislation and a lot of advocacy, a lot of fights and a lot of progress around those of us in the disability community getting access to education, going to school, having the opportunity to be mainstreamed along with all our other peers and learning in those classrooms with accommodations that help us and supports us in our learning process. But the advocacy and the importance of including youth and or adults with disabilities to have equal and fair access to sex ed information has become a much more difficult conversation and debate. But again, if we acknowledge back to that initial point that I made, that people with disabilities, young, old, are people with full range of emotional and sexual expression identity, we need to have a right to have access to that information in the best ways that work for us. The good news is that, you know, community cultural values and ideas and practices are not written in stone. There is some fluidity. And just as in the larger disability justice work, through a lot of advocacy, education, and work from the disability community leadership, we've had, you know, a lot of progress around employment issues, access to education issues. I think it can just equally be successful in pushing for those of us with disabilities to have access to respecting and being seen as sexual beings. To that end, I spent some time talking about some of the stereotypes and challenges. I want to focus on the positive side of sexual education. The importance of sex ed is that if you share information around providing comprehensive sex ed, it sends the message that sexual development is normal and natural, and it is. We grow up as human beings, you know, as we grow into from childhood to puberty to adolescence to adulthood, and as part of that natural progression, kind of acknowledging, experiencing, and growing into sexual maturity and sexual expression is a normal part of that human development. Just because a person has a disability, whether that's a physical impairment, or mobility impairment, sensory impairment, cognitive or intellectual, or chronic mental health, or chronic health condition, whatever the disability condition may be, because they're a person, they still experience, in their way, in their journey, the growth into sexual identity. So helping to understand that sexual development is normal, it also promotes a positive body image. There's been, you know, historically in mass media, through stories and media and TV and music and other sorts of media, representations of people with disabilities and the attitude around people with disabilities is not a very positive experience. I remember growing up and hearing from friends and colleagues, you know, our experiences of seeing people on TV or in books or in movies or in other representations, and predominantly, you know, someone with disabilities always kind of tied to a message of someone who is not independent, who has been taken care of or rescued by an able-bodied person, and or whose body is not seen as normal or attractive. But again, just talking about and framing sexuality as normal and as natural, and helping someone with a disability understand that their body is okay, it's perfectly normal for them, it works for them. Yes, it's different, but difference doesn't mean bad. And I think that's also an important message that is important to say, is that difference isn't a bad thing, just different. Comprehensive sex ed also facilitates healthy relationships. If people in the disability community are not, if society says, oh, well, people with disabilities don't need to have sex or should not have sex, therefore we don't need to teach them that, and then they don't know, then those of us in the disability community do not get the information about how to navigate romantic relationships, dating, friendships, whatnot. That lack of knowledge can create opportunities for people to make everything from small mistakes to being incredibly at risk for victimization or being abusive. So educating on sexuality and helping people with disabilities understand how to navigate sexual relationships, and also helping people understand what their body parts and sexual organs are called, their actual names or proper names or proper functions. This information will help them navigate relationships as they move toward relationships. It will help them understand what friendships are, what the boundaries around friendship are, what the boundaries around dating are. When they have situations where they want to become more sexual and experiment sexually, having the information as to accurate information as to what various sex acts and sexual experiences can be, and having the language to communicate and ask and talk and communicate with their partner will help them formulate positive, healthy relationships and respect each other's boundaries. Similarly, proper sex education will promote health and hygiene, whether it's, understanding for female identified individuals as they move into puberty and adulthood, understanding menstruation and how to manage that. For male-fied folks, again, understanding the importance of taking, kind of monitoring and paying attention to their testicular or their penile health and situation, and just kind of acknowledging those, and again, having them informed as to what is important in terms of hygiene and care and what is healthy. So again, just like everyone is taught how to take care of their bodies in healthy ways, part of their body is their sex organs. And again, getting a basic understanding of what is healthy and some basic instruction on how to maintain that and take care of it, again, helps with overall wellness. And again, all of that information, understanding what sex is, what sexual activities are, how to navigate those situations, with all that knowledge, having that knowledge can reduce the risk of victimization. Because if someone with a disability is informed of what consent is and is educated that their body is their body, that they have the choice to say no, they have the choice in terms of their sex organs, that those are private, private parts versus public parts, and they understand those types of relationships and are given the tools and the language to communicate both consent and how to say no, that if they're in a situation where someone does try to be coercive or abusive, they have the information and the language to disclose and to say, someone tried to hurt me or someone abused me, and this is how. Again, that information can arm someone with a disability to better navigate health relationships, better navigate sexual relationships, and ultimately that knowledge will reduce risk. Okay. So, again, this I want to share a little bit about a new law that came into effect earlier this year. Last year, there was through a lot of collaboration and a lot of work between the disability advocacy community organizations and some legislators. HB 3299 was proposed and became law as of January of this year. And as you can see, this piece of legislature is such that it allows people with disabilities, intellectual and developmental disabilities, to receive sex ed information if they want. It's a piece of legislation that says if you are identified that adults with intellectual and developmental disabilities who are receiving services at residential facilities or in day programs, if they can request access to sex ed information, and that provider needs to work with them to find that information and provide that information for that person. When this legislation became law, a statewide working group came together that has two committees that are currently meeting and working. There's a curriculum committee that is made up of individuals from DHS, disability providers, and folks who identify as having intellectual or developmental disabilities, self-advocates. They meet regularly. The curriculum committee has been working to review and has looked over several evidence-based curricula that have information on comprehensive sex ed that are aimed at providing education on sex ed education for people with disabilities. And they're vetting the curricula and developing some recommendations, and we'll share those and the curricula that the committee feels has good content, meets the criteria of the new law, that will be put together into a resource list, a resource directory that will be made publicly available. Similarly, there's also a committee that is looking at policy and advocacy, and developing some guidelines to assist service providers. Whether that's residential facilities or other organizations providing services to the intellectual and developmental community, giving them some guidelines and some toolkits to help look at internal policies and procedures to some guidance into how to adapt or update policies and procedures to assist and support the consumers that organizations are serving, so that when the adults that the organizations are serving have questions around dating, flirting, relationships, sexual expression, sexual interest, that the organization can look to these toolkits and look to other resources to help them identify and incorporate this type of information into their existing services and existing resources. Okay. The next couple of slides are again, some basic, as part of basic human rights, sexual rights that are identified by self-advocates. These were pulled from a video that was put together by a self-advocacy group. One of the later slides has the YouTube link that you all can look at, which will feature self-advocates talking about their rights. But I think it was important to include, you know, some of the important rights that are mentioned is the right for that people with disabilities have the same rights as anybody else. And again, that goes back to that first initial idea that I mentioned, is that we're people. You know, one of the ongoing arguments and fights that many of us in the disability community continue to push for is to be seen as people. And as people, we have the same rights as anybody else, including the right to date, the right to marry, the right to explore parenthood and become parents and have families just like anybody else. Similarly, you know, not to compare, but, you know, just as the LGBT community has had a long history of fighting for their right to be seen and respected, to have the right to marry. Many of us in the disability community have had a similar, if not legal battle, a cultural battle of getting society to see us as people who have the right to date, to get married, and to have kids. Again, not comparing the two communities, but just as recognizing a similar type of struggle. The right to have loving relationships, the right to explore sexual expression. Okay. Also, kind of moving on to the next slide, is the idea of the right to engage in consensual sex and sexual expression. Consent for sex is complicated and yet also somewhat simple. It's simple in the sense that consent is either yes or no. How consent is communicated is where it can become tricky. And again, that's part of the importance of educating people with disabilities around what consent is. Consent is the active choice of agreeing to participate in a sexual activity. The active, intentional choice of saying, yes, I agree, I want to do this, and I want to participate. And it's important to, you know, when this question or this conversation comes up, to help them understand language, talk about different words and the definition of different words, how body language can communicate yes or no. Help them understand, also, you know, it could be also talking and communicating and educating the person with a disability about euphemistic language and getting an understanding of how they perceive and how what their understanding of euphemistic language is, or the words that they used in terms of how do they convey yes, no, agreement, disagreement. And then, you know, helping them understand how to apply those types of communication tactics that works for them, how they can communicate and share that to others, to their friends, their community providers, in terms of sexual relationships and sexual expression, how that can play out in sexual encounters. Okay. Also helping them understand when it around in talking about sexual identity and sexual expression is the importance of privacy, appropriate situations and circumstances to discuss or engage in sexual activity. You know, just and just like we go through times of teaching and learning about appropriate behaviors for work, for school, for public, for private spaces, you know, include sexual behavior, sexual contact, sexual expression. What is appropriate? When is it appropriate? Helping the individual with disability understand when it's okay to talk about sexual stuff or ask sexual questions or use sexual language. When and where and who is appropriate and when it's not. Again, helping them understand those limits and those boundaries. Okay. And just, you know, as we move toward the end of this conversation, just as, again, to reiterate, and really, I'm asking and I'm hoping that one of the main takeaways that you get from this is to really keep this notion that sexuality is normal and that healthy sexuality is good. Positive, healthy sexual encounters is something that we all, as human beings, would like to experience. There's a lot of pleasure, a lot of good feelings associated with it. In however way, you know, however sexual expression identifies for each individual. And I think that's important to really, really accept and help convey is that healthy sexuality relationships, healthy sexual encounters that involve free consent, willing consent, positive sexual identity, sexual expression, overall is a healthy, positive, good thing. And try to remove the shame around it. I mean, one of the things that frustrates me is just in mass media, in conversation, or in humor, that sexuality is tainted with, oh, being dirty or being or kind of shameful or negative imagery. And I think that's a disservice because we all, on some level, want to experience positive sexual behavior. And ultimately, positive sexuality is a very powerful thing. So just kind of helping to move to that area and conveying that message that sexuality is normal, sexual identity is positive, and helping them understand that and accept it within their individual family and cultural value system. Okay. Next few slides is when you get these handouts, these are some books and resources that may be helpful for you in terms of it can also be helpful for some individuals with disabilities to hear stories or information, whether it's these books that are listed here. These are some websites with some toolkits. Can also be helpful for some of these are appropriate for parents as well as adults and some young folks. And then, as I mentioned earlier, I think there are some really good YouTube videos of varying. Some are like 4 or 5 minutes long. Some of them are up to an hour. But the collection of YouTube videos that I listed here, I think, are really good in terms of hearing from self-advocate voices around what sexuality means for them and what's important for information around access for information, access for resources, as well as just people within the disability community sharing their experiences And that information hopefully will be helpful for providers, self-advocates to reflect on. And with that, I'll open up for questions.
Thank you, Jae Jin. That was great information. I want to encourage people to type their questions in the chat box. Again, the chat box is in the lower right-hand corner. Click on the icon that has a speech bubble and type in your questions. And while we're waiting for people to type in questions, I also want to remind people that for handouts today, you can log into your profile at the website where you registered, accessibilityonline.org/IDH. And after you log in, go to My Sessions and click on Today's Sessions, and you'll be able to scroll down and find the session materials that you're able to download and print. So feel free to type any questions in.
Also, while we're waiting, resource that I want to share that I didn't get a chance to put in the slides is there is a late last year, the National Council on Centers for Independent Living, National Council on Independent Living, put out a video series with an accompanying PDF guide, printed guide, that I think it's like sex ed for adults with IDD. So if you do a Google search, you'll find it's a series of 10 short YouTube videos. And then there's also an accompanying PDF guide that's in plain language that does a really fabulous job of providing some information around a lot of these topics around sexuality.
Great. Thanks for sharing that resource. We do have a question, Jae Jin. Somebody asked, The law that you're talking about for sex ed, is it just for adults or for schools too?
HB 3299, I believe, it is a law for adults 18 plus, receiving some kind of in community living services or some type of program like that.
Great. Thank you for clarifying.
So, yeah, primarily for adults.
Great. And feel free to type other questions into the chat box. Another question we have is, what if an agency does not have sexuality policies?
That's a good question. And I think and there may be several organizations that don't have explicit policies on how to support their consumers or adults with disabilities around sexuality. And I think it's important for those organizations, if you are aware of that, or if you're a provider or staff person at an organization, and this is something that hasn't come up, is to ask and find out, and not as a criticism or as a challenge, but this is an opportunity to work with your organization, staff, and leadership to think through and develop policies and practices to support the adults you serve. How can we help them and support them when these questions come up? And the committees, the HB, the committees that I mentioned in the next, in the upcoming weeks and months, will be releasing information and recommendations that can be very helpful for organizations to refer to or to help kind of developing those practices too. So there will be resources to help you with that.
Great, thank you, Jae Jin. And somebody just put into the chat box the link for the resource just mentioning. So thank you for putting that link in so that other people
can
see that. Also, we have another question. What about social narratives for parents to introduce to their kids as they begin to have sexual desires?
I'm sorry, what was that?
Do you have any resources that have social narratives for parents to be able to introduce their kids as they begin having sexual desires? So kind of social stories related to sexuality and types of things. Do you have resources about that? Or children as they get
off the top of my head, I can't think of any, but I think in one of the resources that's on one of the on the resource slide. I think something about healthy. Yeah, the healthy bodies for boys and girls may have some resources. I can think of one of my colleagues here at UIC also does a lot of work, and I can check with her and can follow up with any additional resources around that, because I actually don't, top of my head, I'm not aware of any more.
Great. Thanks, Jae Jin. We have another question asking, how does the law address situations where a guardian is against a sexual relationship?
That's a good question, and that is can become complicated. Guardians, the importance of guardianship is, you know, the guardian's primary role is to help and support and protect the individual with a disability. Having said that, it's not to control the individual with a disability's life. The individual with a disability in a guardian relationship still has. It's still important for the guardian to listen and respect the individual with disabilities' desires, hopes, and dreams, inclusive of a person's desire to explore relationships and dating and sexual expression. I think it's important for people who are guardians and who are working in the field of guardianship to understand that, and you know, if the person's desires are ultimately hurtful, you know, if they're moving into someone with an abusive relationship or someone's exploiting them sexually, then yes, that's something that the guardian needs to help their individual disability understand and move toward safety. But aside from that, if it's just, you know, someone, if the guardian, I guess, yeah, all of that to say, as you can tell, it can get complicated, but I think it's the importance of helping the guardian understand not to overstep. And if you're a fellow member, or if you're a colleague, or and you are concerned that a guardian is, even under the best of circumstances and the best of intentions, isn't hearing or recognizing a person's sexual expression, then doing what you can in tactful, polite, and appropriate ways to help them kind of understand and move toward being more accepting and more aware.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, and can I add as well,
please,
from my perspective, I think that it can sometimes be helpful for organizations to kind of take a dual approach of not only educating people with disabilities around sexual health and sexual relationships, but also working with guardians. There is some natural fear around it for some guardians around this topic. Sometimes providing some training and education targeted to the guardians to help alleviate some of those fears, to help understand how they can support in their role the sexual relationships and sexual expression of the people with disabilities that they support, could be a helpful kind of dual approach that agencies could take. Somebody said, while states have different guidelines for Illinois guardians determine where to live, where to work, no. So I think that's a question. I think maybe I'll just say, you know, the National Guardianship Association has clearly stated that, you know, the guardian's primary role is to support what the person's disabilities wants. That doesn't always get implemented in that way, but that really is the primary role for guardians, not to to support in those that the person wants. I'm looking. I want to thank you so much, Jae Jin, for sharing all of this information and expertise. Here is Jae Jin's contact information in the slide. If you have additional questions, feel free to reach out to Jae Jin. And I also want to let you know that our next webinar is going to be held on May 13th at noon on the dual diagnosis of Down syndrome and autism spectrum disorder presented by Dr. Katie Frank. So please feel free to register and join us for that. Thank you so much for joining today. Take care.